Hey friends, welcome back to Everything 101. You know, if you've been watching my channel for any amount of time, you probably know that I'm a big fan of the movie Salem's Lot. It came out in 1979, November the 17th. It was a TV series adaptation of the Stephen King novel, Salem's Lot. You know, I think one of the reasons that this movie is my favorite even today is because it just absolutely terrified me. Had such a profound impact on me as a kid. Couldn't sleep by myself for weeks. But, you know, the part that really got me the most was the first really scary scene in the movie, and that is the character Ralphie Glick, a young boy who had gone missing. And Ralphie Glick is now floating outside of his brother's window, and he's wanting to be let in, and he's scratching on the window. That part just terrified me. I was scared to death, and I just loved the whole scene. But Ralphie Glick was played by actor Ron Scribner. Ron Scribner has a vast repertoire of movies and TV shows that he was in. And so I had the amazing honor and privilege of catching up with Ron recently for a phone interview. And I'm very excited to bring you that interview right now. Let's get to it. It's my great pleasure to welcome the man himself, Ron Scribner. Ron, thank you so much for hanging out with me.
Danny, my pleasure. Absolutely my pleasure.
And this is incredible. I just want to say this up front, and I believe I probably told you this in a message or something before, but you know, I've met a lot of celebrities, and I don't get starstruck, but I'm a little starstruck right now because of the profound impact that you had on me as a kid. It's just amazing to be talking to you, and I appreciate it.
I'm humbled and honored. I'm appreciative. I'm dumbfounded often that from some people, and I appreciate that. I don't think I'm worthy of that, but it's appreciated. Yeah. I wouldn't go so far as to say I'm uncomfortable, although I completely am with it. I mean, I've got a big mouth. I'm not shy about anything. but it's humbling to hear somebody say that, you know, that I had an impact on their life and that they remembered me from so many years ago. So thank you for that.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure.
You hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you. Thank you. So I just, if you don't mind, I want to go back to the beginning, you know, Fantasy Island, The Love Boat, Chips, Little House on the Prairie, so many things. How did you get into acting in the very beginning?
So, my sister, a couple years younger than me, was having lunch with my mother and father at the time. And my father worked very close to the Paramount Studios lot in mm-hmm. Hollywood. And an agent came up to her and said that she looked television worthy tested her. And my sister had done a couple of commercials.
Okay.
And I went to Paramount Studios, the lot, with my mother and father and my sister. And the same agent noticed me and said, you know, would you be interested in doing television? And
yeah,
I didn't care, didn't have any clue what it meant, and said, mm-hmm. sure. And I started working almost immediately. Wow. I think the first thing I did was a Dean's chocolate milk commercial. In the early 70s.
Cool.
I think it was like a local manufacturer. I think it was like in Illinois. It wasn't a California uh-huh. producer of milk or anything like that. But that was like the first thing I did. And I was doing some JCPenney catalogs, doing a little bit of, you know, child modeling, and went from print work to commercial work to television work pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. You know, I think it's a total of maybe 52 shows that I was on. I think the last thing I did, I was 18. First thing I did, I was 9.
Wow. That's a run. Man. Well, let's go up to 79. How did you end up with the role of Ralphie Glick?
Similar to how I started in the business, myself and, you know, hundreds of other people, went on a casting call, mm-hmm. and I forget who the casting director was. That was quite a while ago. But I applied, read scenes from a draft script. Mm-hmm. I don't believe Toby was there in the initial interview phase. You know, you just present your headshots, pictures of yourself, and yeah. read some scenes. They'll have somebody there that reads the scenes with you, read those scenes. And I believe I was reading the scenes from interaction with Lance Kerwin's character at the time. It was not Lance Kerwin or any of the actors. And mm-hmm. then you go back for a series of what they call callbacks.
Yeah.
And I think it was 3 callbacks total. And on the last one, Toby Hooper was there.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But still none of the character actors that were on the show.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So November 17th, 79 comes around. Did you and your family sit down and watch the movie?
We did. And it was monumental. It was epic. It was epic in the sense that I was in the movie and it scared the living crap out of me.
Me too.
mean, well, you know, it's interesting. It's my kids don't like the movie. It they were bored to death and they're like, "Dad, it's grainy. You know, it's not HD. It's not high def, and it's not Lucas yeah. sound 7.2 or anything like that." And
yeah.
my response was, "It's a classic Stephen King 70s horror movie where you're scared by the music, not the blood."
Absolutely.
And there wasn't, I mean, I don't think there was any blood in the movie. No, I think there was, you know, dried blood from the dog at the gravesite.
Yeah.
But, you know, nobody's head was getting snapped off or anything like that. And the music was just petrifying.
Uh-huh.
The cinematography, all of that combined scared the living daylights out of me.
Man, see, I was going to ask you when you saw it with the music and all of that, what were you thinking? But it scared you then. That's interesting.
Absolutely. Yeah, it scared me. I mean, you know, there were scenes because we're only there for our snippets. We don't ever get to see it. And they never film in sequence, obviously, mm-hmm. yeah. And for obvious reasons, you know, economics, probably the biggest reason.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe you're filming the end of the movie and then maybe you're the next day filming a beginning scene in the movie mm-hmm. Because they're in the same location, but
yeah.
you don't get that perspective or that benefit of the scenes rolling together. To me, mm-hmm. that's where the editing room floor is so important, because you can take a very well done movie and screw it up with bad editing.
Yeah.
And I think the editing was done very well in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
All the scenes rolled together. One ending scene ended, and the next scene that picked up from that ending scene, you weren't confused and said, "Hey, wait, what happened?" So, mm-hmm. yeah, once all those were put together, I got the daylight scared out of me and the music and
yeah.
my family. And, you know, we had been able to see a preview of the film before it was released. Before it went out on, uh-huh. on television. And then when we saw it on television, I got a lot of accolades at school the following day.
I bet you did. Wow. So I've heard some stories. Can you talk about the contacts and the fangs and the makeup and what all that was like?
The most memorable story that I think that the day that they were the apparatus to float in the window.
Yeah.
And you know, it's comical now. Because it's pretty rudimentary, basic special effects. They hung me from a crane mm-hmm. in a body harness. But to hang me in the body harness, they had to take a mold of my body.
Wow.
So imagine a 13-year-old boy butt naked on Burbank Studios as they took the body cast off.
Oh.
And while they were doing that, the Burbank Studios tram drove by.
Oh.
Full of...
No way.
Full of people. So yeah, it was quite an experience. But they did that, and then Christopher Reeves, his scenes flying in Superman were based off that technology, the body harness and a crane. So, you know, I can say we did it first.
Yeah, really.
Before Superman did. That was pretty memorable. The harness was pretty uncomfortable. I mean, it was a fiberglass harness lined with sheepskin and then sewn together with a big giant crane apparatus sticking out of the back. And I hung in that thing for hours on end, and that harness was from my armpit down to my knees.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, it's not like they let you out because it takes you an hour to get put into it. You just hung there for hours upon hours and did that for days upon days.
Oh my gosh.
And the eyes, you know, a vampire's eyes, they put contacts in my eyes, and I had a bad reaction. The contacts rolled into the back of my head.
Oh my gosh.
The back of my eyeballs. And, you know, we had to get the set doctor to give me, don't quote me. Well, you're quoting me. I believe it was a steroid shot. Or not a shot, but drops. I believe it was steroid drops. Something to keep my eyes from going nuts like they were going, so that they could relax. And maybe it was to relax my eyelids so that they could just massage my eyeballs to get the contacts to roll back in. And then when I thought that I was going to get some relief, they're like, okay, next scene's coming up. Put the contacts right back in.
Oh my gosh.
Yes. Wow. The one scene, so it was uncomfortable, but you know, hey, I was a thespian. I did what was required of me with no complaints, and to this day still would. One thing that grotesqued me, bad grammar. I have a PTSD from the scene to this day, when all of our bodies were in the basement and we started coming after David Soul and Lance Kerwin.
Yeah.
Well, the set had a couple hundred pounds of rotten potatoes with maggots. And they were real live maggots climbing in and out of the potatoes. I don't know if that was intentional or not, but they were there, and there was a stench that was nauseating.
Oh my gosh.
And to try to squash the stench, they sprayed Lysol. So to this day, I get vomitous if I smell Lysol in the house or anywhere I'm at. There can't be any Lysol, because it just brings me back to rotting potatoes and maggots from the basement scene of Salem's Lot.
Oh my gosh.
13 years old on Burbank Studios.
I've never heard that. That is crazy.
It was pretty wild. You know, Reggie was as scary with makeup on as he was without. I mean, he was a character that was always in character. So he was pretty scary out of his makeup. David Soul, Lance Kerwin, all the actors were great to work with.
All right. So I want to talk about your disappearance quickly. You shot it in Sequoia Park in Eureka, which I visited in the summer. And obviously I couldn't find a place exactly where you guys filmed that. It's a big park and things have changed, I'm sure. I'm just curious, when you see the black shadow come up in front of you, was that done in post, or was there actually someone there, and who was it?
Done in post.
Oh, it was done in post. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely done in post.
All right. How was that night filming out there?
Freezing cold, wet, and they had used big studio fans, you know, to generate that wind. Uh-huh. And I'm talking fans that, you know, make you feel like you're in a hurricane.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And it was probably at 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, the Coogan law, as a minor, we're only allowed to work 4 hours a day. And then we have, studio schooling 4 hours a day for an 8 hour day. So at the end of 8 hours, as required by law, my mother and I left the set. And then we waited for our studio. And then 30 minutes later, my mother and I turned back around, went back on set in the park and filmed till probably 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning.
Oh my gosh.
But again, that's what you did. I mean,
yeah.
It's not a coincidence that there are so many twins mm-hmm. in television, because they get to double the amount of studio time that they work. So when you're not a twin, you go home after 8 hours, or if you want to work, you go back to the set after the 8 hours when the teachers have gone and stay there till all hours of the night. And we did that for a few nights. We definitely did it when we were working at the park, and no regrets, and loved it. And it helped the production of the film, helped keep it on budget and on time. And you know, I'm like I said earlier, a thespian.
Yeah. So you do what you got to do.
Yeah. And I had family in that area. So we were very close to the water, which made it even colder. We went over to the water afterwards, spent some time with them, a couple of days. It was scary there. We had trailers, so we weren't sitting on benches, but we were sitting on chairs, you know, when we were waiting for our scenes. But if we weren't going to be on scene, then we would just go wait in our trailers for the day, and they were right on set. We were there for a couple of days.
Yeah.
You know, that filming, like I said, it was cold, it was uncomfortable, it was late at night. It wasn't really scary because, you know, a couple hundred people that were there, maybe not that many, but, you know, it was full of studio people.
Yeah, yeah.
Production people.
You know, I want to ask you about, everybody talks about, all the fans mentioned that when James Mason carries you into the basement after you've been abducted, you are very small in his arms. And so it's kind of clear that he's probably not carrying you. Are we right? And what might have been,
you are correct. He's not carrying me. And there's been a lot of family conversation and fan conversation about that. Uh-huh. Was it an effort to make him look larger and more powerful? Was it an oversight by, you know, set decorator? I don't have a clear answer for that, but or did they break me in half, you know, and bring me in pieces?
Yeah.
The only person that knows that's probably, you know, not available to answer. It was not me, obviously. And I don't have a definitive answer as to why I was so small. I also, you know, on that note, why did I disappear in jeans and a windbreaker and then shown in pajamas coming through the window?
I
don't have an answer for that either. There's tons of theories. I haven't been on QAnon's website, but there's probably one from them too.
There probably is. You know, I've always kind of said, you know, clearly Danny, they said we're taking him to the hospital or get Dr. Norton, but then he's in his bedroom, but we know he's really at the hospital. So I guess my theory has always been, the first time you appear, he's dreaming. It's sort of, you know, Ralphie's giving him this, I don't know, look ahead of what's coming. He's making him see the vision. And then maybe he actually comes in the hospital. He's really there. So I don't know. I kind of figured that the first one was a dream. So that's why you're both in PJs.
That, you know, that would fill in a couple of blanks. Hopefully when they do the new film, you and I will have our answers.
Yeah, maybe so.
If they stay true to the original film.
Yes, I hope they do. I was going to ask you your thoughts on that, but yeah, I hope they do stay true to it and do it well and really scary. And cause I'm sorry, the 2004 version was lame.
Yeah, it was. It was lame. We'll just leave it at that. I have a feeling though. I mean, you know, with CGI and, you know, with special effects, I have a feeling they'll capitalize on it. You know, the art of the cinematography and the sound. I don't know if they're going to be able to capture the audience and maintain, the excitement, if they don't show some gore, and they're probably going to take some poetic license on it and just make it something new and improved. And you know, and all the more power to them if they, if they do it well. I don't think it would make it if it were a scene for scene reenactment of Toby Hooper's version.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. And you know what I would love to do? I guess you're planning to go see Salem's Lot in the theater.
I am. Although for Christmas I got a big TV, so I might just watch it at home. I got a big 86 inch TV.
I was going to say I would fly to California just to watch that movie with you. So,
well, if you were going to be in California, I'd go see the movie with you.
Okay. Well,
you and I almost got together over the summer. I mean, our schedules conflicted. You know, I went back and looked at our history. We've been communicating and trying to get together for quite some time. One of these days we'll make it.
Yes. But hey, you tell me where you're going. I will fly out there. I'm telling you.
Well, if you go to Ferndale again, I met my girlfriend in Ferndale, and there's a cute story about Ferndale and Salem's Lot and my girlfriend. So it has a special place in my heart. We go back there several times a year. I'll tell you the story if you're interested in hearing it.
So, yeah, absolutely.
I was single. My girlfriend was single, and I met her on a dating app. It was Match.com. Mm-hmm. And the first few times I had tried to get her attention, she ignored me. I mean, first few times, heck, for the first couple of weeks, she ignored me. And finally, one day I said, hey, I feel like a stalker. If you're not interested in me, I keep swiping or clicking or liking or waving or whatever the thing is to let them know you're interested. And I've got yet to receive a response from you. And she says, well, you look mean. And that was the first response I got from her. And I said, I'm fat and bald and old. Of course I look mean. But I'm not mean. And so we started talking and we hit it off.
Yeah.
And a couple of weeks into this online relationship, she had texted me really late one night. And I pointed it out. I said, you're texting me really late. And she said, yeah, I just got my daughter to bed. She's having nightmares from this movie that we watched.
Oh, no.
And I have a clue what she's, and I'm like, really, what movie? And she's like, oh, you wouldn't know it. This cheesy 70s film. No. We just spent the weekend in my favorite town where they filmed the movie. And so I'm like, well, what town? And she said, Ferndale. Well,
oh my gosh.
So I'm like, well, what movie? And she said, Salem's Lot.
Oh my gosh.
So I said this pickup line I've never used before or since. I said, Google my name.
Oh Lord.
She said, what do you mean? I said, just Google my name. And then type in Salem's Lot. And she did. And she's like, I don't get it. I don't understand it. So all these, you know, these hits on Google started coming back, and I said, I was in the movie. I was Ralphie Glick. And she's like, you've got to be kidding me. This is, you're catfishing me. And we hadn't met or anything. And she's like, you know, the internet is really weird. And she's a really conservative, girl.
Yeah.
Not very technically savvy. So I'm serious. I'm not that technically adept. I don't think I could fake that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So she agreed to meet me, and we met. She goes, I'm either gonna meet a BS artist or I'm gonna meet Ralphie Glick.
Yeah.
And so if you're actually real and you're really Ralphie Glick, then you know it will have all been worth it because it's my favorite movie. And,
oh my gosh.
Well, Danny, that was almost 8 years ago, and we've been together every day since then.
That is amazing.
So, and I owe that to Salem's Lot.
That is, yeah, I mean,
fun story. She was with me on the 40-year anniversary. I told that story there.
Oh, my
gosh. We went back to Ferndale and spent the weekend there and was on stage before the movie, before the movie played, and did a little bit of a Q&A, and I told that story there. So, I mean, I think it's cute.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, that little role in 1979 would lead to finding the love of my life. And,
God, man, what are the chances? Yeah,
that's fun.
Oh, man.
Yeah, a million and one.
God.
Maybe you and I'll meet there and we'll go over some of the scenes. And when we go there, of course, we go, you know, where were all the scenes filmed. Where was the boarding house? Where was the Marston house? Mm-hmm. Where's the cemetery? So we go to as many places as we can go to for everything that was filmed in Ferndale. And Amanda, my girlfriend's name's Amanda. She, you mm-hmm. know, she thinks I'm this big star in Ferndale, but I still pay full retail when I go there.
Oh, man, they should cut you a now, break.
Yeah, they don't. Now, I don't know if you're aware of April, a big, big Salem's Lot fan. She owns the bookstore yep. there in Ferndale. And she has been very kind to us. And we're good friends. We communicate quite frequently on social media to this mm-hmm. day. Every time we go to Ferndale, we go to visit her. And, you know, so we've made some good friends. The guy that owns the theater there, we're friends with him. I mean, I'm a closet carpenter, and he is as well. So I admire that church, the theater that he's got there. And Ferndale is one of my favorite places in California.
Oh, man, it's one of my favorite places. Absolutely. I do plan to go back. I wanted to ask you about a lot of the fans want to know, especially one of your fans, Greg Lavers. He was asking about filming the window scenes. You've said that you filmed them backwards, and he was asking how did they coach you? You know, you're a young guy. How did they coach you in pulling off that scene, and what was the process of filming it?
So my coach was Toby Hooper.
Wow. Okay.
He was the guy that articulated what he wanted as a finished product. I mean, you know, I don't have any concept during that time of what the scene was going to look like. I mean, I've got a script, and I'm reading the script, and, you know, it'll open scene, you know, window open, smoke comes in, and Ralphie Glick floats through the window. I mean, there's that kind of information that's available to me, but I don't have any concept. I mean, it's in a commercial, they do drawings of the scenes, the shots. But in a movie, they don't typically do those video boards like that. So Toby literally articulated that the smoke's going to be coming in, but it's going to have this special effect, Ronnie. And the only way we're going to be able to achieve that effect is by filming it backwards. So he would mimic what he wanted me to do. So he would, like, if I'm doing a scene to where my hand is going forward and I'm doing like a scraping motion, he would start where the finishing of the motion, like where I'm scratching the window. So he'd say, put your hands here. This is where I want you to end up. And then here's where I want you to start. And so let's just go through the motions. And we just practiced. And then he'd run through and film, and we'd look at it on camera to see if it looked like he wanted it to look like. So we practiced a few times. But I caught on to what it was he was trying to achieve. And when I duplicated it, you know, like Pavlov's dogs, didn't take me too long to catch on. And just filmed them backwards. And that's how we got the smoke scenes. And it did have, like, when I was, the scene opened, like the last one, with me biting him.
Yeah.
That was, excuse me, the scene ended with me biting him in the neck. Right. Well, obviously we filmed it backwards. So when they said action, my teeth were on his neck and I pulled my teeth off of his neck and lifted up. So it was amplified. I mean, those movements in a weird, unnatural way. When they filmed it in forward motion to show me biting him, I think that it made it look all that more scary and eerie looking when they played it forward, because of my unnatural movements of taking my teeth off of his neck and putting my head back as opposed to starting out that way and then moving down to bite his neck.
Wow. Okay. So now that you're saying this, I know exactly what you're talking about. I can see it now. Man, that is crazy. Huh.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if that was by design or intent. You know, Toby's smarter than we gave him credit for if it was, but I mean, that was how it ended up. It just looked really just freaky with, you know, the way my head reared up after biting his neck. But yeah, it turned out great. I wanted to get the scene over because I was uncomfortable in that damn harness.
Yeah. Yeah. And I guess it was kind of weird too, with your teeth resting on Brad Savage's neck too. That might've felt a little uncomfortable.
It, when you're 13, you're uncomfortable.
How much did you and Brad and Lance hang out offset?
Not much. Offset, like during filming, we did hang out because while we were offset, we were still on location.
Yeah.
But afterwards, I think, Brad and I got together in a few events. Lance was a little bit older than Brad and I. Brad and I, we were in the same circles. We competed for the same films, tried out for the same parts. Oh. So I ran into Brad a lot more than I ran into Lance outside of Salem's Lot. We didn't really hang out. Later on in life, I didn't connect with any of my other co-stars or actors or actresses. Mm-hmm. I ran into Bonnie Bedelia a couple times. But Brad and I, we connected, about... Oh, maybe 10 years ago, briefly. Mm-hmm. Brad's got, he's still a little bit in the business. I'm no longer in the business. I'm in banking. He does a lot of voiceover work. It just logistically doesn't work for us. Our social circles are different. I'm in banking in Northern California. He's in Hollywood in Southern California.
Yeah.
I did have a crush on his sister, so I did try to hang out with him as much as possible. His sister, Tracy Savage, Tracy. I don't know if you, yes.
Yeah.
I think it was Friday the 13th or one of the horror films. She was in the shower scene. So yeah, I had a big crush on her.
Oh yeah. That's cool. Do you still keep up with anyone from the movie today? I know you were talking about Brad and them, but any of the other actors that you ever see?
I don't.
Okay.
I really don't. No reason why I don't, other than, life happens.
Yeah, right.
And if I'm not in the film industry, it doesn't have my attention or my focus. Mm-hmm. Nobody from the film. I did for quite a few years, some of the production people I had a relationship with. One of the assistant producers was a family friend, and we were friends until he passed away. I don't have a relationship with anybody from the film.
Gotcha. Well, if you don't mind, and I don't want to hold you up too long, but I got a short list of a couple of fan questions, if you don't mind.
Sure, absolutely, not a problem.
Yeah. So one of your fans, Dan Cassati, really cool guy. He asked a couple of things. He says, what do you remember most, your favorite memories? Do you have any vintage photos, recordings? And he also asked, was it Reggie Nalder a nice guy?
Reggie Nalder was a very nice guy. Quiet guy, French guy. I'm going to say weird, but I don't mean it in a derogatory sense. He was weird because he was a nice, quiet French guy. Uh-huh. And a 13-year-old boy's not used to a nice, quiet French guy. I mean, just character traits. James Mason was this large, ominous, scary character, English, very gentlemanly. But Reggie was this, little French guy that was old and weird. But mm-hmm. the nicest guy in the world. I mean, everybody on the set was nice. I was scared of James Mason just because he was a big guy, and the character that he played in the film, he kind of carried that persona off the screen in character for a while. Total gentleman. Everybody was a gentleman. I remember the shame, embarrassment and humiliation of being naked when they took the body cast off in front of the tour bus.
Oh my gosh.
Now I laugh about it. I mentioned to you the smell I remember from the basement scene.
Yeah.
I do have some photographs, nothing that's not commercially available. I don't have any secret stash, and I don't have any set props or anything like that. I've never worn contacts again since then. That's because of Salem's Lot. I wear glasses.
Yeah.
I don't want anything rolling in the back of my head. You know, I remember the body cast very well. I remember making it. I remember Toby Hooper was, and I don't know if it was Tab, Mr. Pibb, Coke, or Pepsi, but he was a soda addict.
Oh, wow.
And I just, it stuck out to me how much this guy drank soda. And I didn't realize that he produced The Nine Lives of Fritz the Cat, if you're familiar with the film.
No, I'm not. I'm not familiar with that.
It's the first X-rated cartoon.
Oh.
My mother didn't want me to do Salem's Lot because Toby Hooper had done The Nine Lives of Fritz the Cat. And of course, when my mom says, I don't want you to do that, I'm going to do the research. I couldn't go on the internet at that time, but I was able to get some information, and it was anticlimactic. It, you know, it was literally a cartoon, no more risque than what you and I see on television today.
Oh yeah, I'm sure.
But back then it was something deep. Yeah. So I don't know if I answered all of his questions.
Yeah, I think so. Greg Lavers wants to know, did you go to public school and how were you treated by your classmates once you returned to normal life?
I did go to public school. There were quite a few years where I spent more time on set than I did in school. I think one time, like, there was out of the school year, I was on set in some capacity 210 days out of a 365 day year.
Wow.
I think that was when I was working the most. I was treated, I mean, I was like 5'2", 126 pounds until I graduated from high school. Mm-hmm. So I got ribbed by my classmates. I mean, I wasn't anything special. And if I ever thought that I was, they were going to make sure that they put me back in my place. I went to school with C. Thomas Howell, who was Ponyboy in The Outsiders. So, C. Thomas Howell and I, we hung out. I tried out for Ponyboy. He got it. So he got more girls than I did because he got that role. But I was still Ralphie Glick.
That's right.
And the only public school downside, my mother would not let me do any sporting activities. So I couldn't play baseball. I couldn't do football or anything like that because I wasn't allowed to get hurt. I ended up rebelling. I said, I want to play football. So I got to play flag football. And like my first play, I got tackled and landed on the back of somebody's cleat that split my lip open. And that was the end of my athletic career.
Oh, no.
Yeah. So my mom's like, of course, I told you so.
Yeah. Oh, man. Kevin Evans wanted to know if you know, why did Ralphie Glick not speak as a vampire? It made him creepy, he thinks, but do you know why?
I don't think that there was any reason why. I don't think he needed to.
I don't either. I mean,
he let his actions speak louder than any words he could have come up with. No clue as to why I didn't have any dialogue as a vampire.
Yeah, well, I think it was creepier and didn't need the lines. Good question, but
good question.
Yeah. Well, okay. So Ellie Smith asked, did you feel the window scene was creepy? We kind of already talked about that. And James Gable says, did you get to keep any props? But you said you don't have any props.
I don't have any, but I did keep my contacts and my fangs.
Whoa. But I mean, I lost them years ago. I got them after the film and lost them years ago. I would have liked to have kept them.
Gosh. Well, Ron, I wanted just to do something really quick at the end here, because I want to let you get back to what you have to do. Could we just zip through some characters very quickly and just share anything quick that you...
Absolutely.
Yeah, just whatever you remember. So first of all, we'll start with Ben Mears, David Soul.
David Soul, you know, Starsky and Hutch. I was starstruck with him.
Okay.
Not a lot of interaction with him. Nothing memorable, which is usually a good thing when you're a teenager on set. You know, like I had done a movie with James Woods, if you're familiar with his character.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I have a lot of memories of James Woods, and they were not good memories. We can talk about that at another time. So I didn't have many of David Soul. I mean, you know, there are some actors, bigger actors like David Soul, to where, you know, their ego walks into the room about 20 minutes before them. He was that type, at least, you know. I don't think that I was that intuitive or tuned with personalities and so forth, that 13, normal, typical 13-year-old. But he seemed like a normal guy, and I was a little starstruck with him, but his head wasn't in the clouds.
Well, you talked a little bit about James Mason, Reggie Nalder. Any memories of Bonnie Bedelia?
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I noticed every time I was on set and she was doing scenes, how focused she was. So some people, you know, they'll shoot the breeze with you. You'll hear somebody say quiet on the set, you know, and we're getting ready to film, and then they'll get ready for her role. I remember Bonnie always preparing, always the consummate professional. Not that everybody else wasn't also the consummate professional, but just it stood out to me how much she was preparing for her role, and she was just beautiful.
Oh yeah. Did you have a lot of interaction with some of these side, I mean, I don't want to call them side characters. There were just so many. I don't want to take all night asking you about every single one, but people like Lou Ayres, Julie Cobb, George DeZunda, Clarissa K. Mason.
Other than Lou Ayres, no. Lou Ayres was such a legend. I mean, he was a legend I didn't know anything about. I didn't know who he was. I mean, I'm 13.
Yeah.
If it wasn't Ponch and John from Chips, I didn't know who they were. But my father educated me on Lou Ayres and his background, and on James Mason, those two specifically. So I went out of my way to spend some time with him, talk with him, engage him. A gentleman, you know, he was very similar to his character in the movie, just a really genuinely nice, sweet man. I have fond memories and think of him affectionately.
Yeah.
But most of the other and side characters is probably pretty appropriate. I mean, I think technically I'm a side character, just, you know, with a memorable scene, but not a lot of interaction with them.
Just what about, you know, Jeffrey Lewis? He went on to do a lot. Fred Willard. How much did you run into those guys?
Not too much. You know, we didn't have a lot of interaction with each other, except for when all the vampires were in the basement. But I got to watch and I got to admire. I would have loved to have spent a lot more time with Jeffrey Lewis and Fred Willard, because they were big stars. You know, but Jeffrey Lewis wasn't a big star at the time. And, you know, if there is, if everybody remembers me at the window, I think equally memorable is Jeffrey in the rocking chair.
Absolutely.
You know, and look at me, teacher. I mean, you know, his his scenes are as ominous and scary as mine. I would have liked to have gotten to know him because of him and Clint Eastwood, and Clint Eastwood is my idol. But I didn't, unfortunately, spend any quality time with them.
Okay. Well, Ron, I just, you know, I'm blown away. I know I said it, but I'm blown away that, you know, I think about, I'm actually talking to that kid at the window. it just blew my mind. It still blows my mind right now that I'm getting to have this conversation with you. So, and I'm just,
probably the one getting the treat, Danny. You know, I've followed you on social media for a while since you and I have been introduced to each other, and you're a genuinely decent human being.
Thank you.
You know, you care about your family, care about what you do, and it's refreshing to see good people out there. The fans throughout the decades have been very respectful, very courteous, very professional. It's funny. I mean, I still, to this day, I get probably two or three letters a month to my work from fans asking me if they can send me a photograph, and like they'll send money for the photograph, and it's, I send their money back to them, and I'm grateful. I'm thankful that anybody would, you know, think that I'm worthy of an autograph. My work kind of freaks out about it because every once in a while they won't be addressed properly. So they'll have to open them up, and they're like, another fan sent a photograph and a pen autograph, and there's $20 in there. I've got a lot of fans from Ireland and from England and from Europe. It's a whole bunch of fans from Ireland. I'm shocked at the congregation of Irish fans that I have. I might not have to pay full retail if I ever go to Ireland. But the fans have been incredible, and people like you, Ben, that's got my image tattooed on his arm.
Yes.
You and he have had some conversations. I'm just, I'm grateful and lucky to be associated with such a good group of fans and people that, keep the show alive. So I'm the fortunate one, not you, but I appreciate that.
And that means a lot. And I will say that I was one of those people many years ago that sent you a picture with a return envelope. And you might find this funny, but that downstairs in my house, we have a TV room, and I have pictures of people that interest me personally. And you are hanging there. And the pen that it's funny, but the gray Sharpie that I sent you, I kept it. I still have it. And it has also been used by numerous other celebrities to sign pictures. That same pen, two of the guys from Kiss have used it. Brad Savage has used it.
Wow. So you got a celebrity pen.
I do. I have a celebrity silver Sharpie, and I kept it. So the one you signed, I still have it.
Well, I mean, you're the early batch. I keep the pens now. Silver Sharpie, cool.
Yeah, those are cool. Well, okay, look, I don't want to be a stalker myself, but I seriously, I'm going to look at when that movie comes out. I would totally fly out there if I could go see that movie with you. I'm serious.
If it's conducive to your schedule, let's do it. Awesome. Pencil me in.
Okay. Awesome. Maybe I can get Ben to come out there too, since he's in California.
That would be a lot of fun.
Man, that'd be great.
Might have to let the girlfriend tag along because, she's as much of a fan of the film as we all are. And, if it's easier, I'll go out to LA, or in Northern Cal. I'm easy. So like I said, pencil me in and see if Ben's down for it too.
Let's do it. Let's make it happen.
All right.
Thank you so much for hanging out with me, Ron. I don't want to hold you up anymore, but thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I know I've said it, but I do appreciate it.
I am as appreciative. So thank you. Say hello to everybody and thank everybody.
You too.
And let's hope that they do the film honorably when they remake it. Let's hope it comes out well, and think good thoughts.
Yeah, let's hope. You got it.
All right, Danny. You have a good
night. All right, you too. Night, thank sir. You so much. See ya. Well, guys, thanks for hanging out with me on this episode of Everything 101. I want to sincerely thank Ron Scribner for taking time to talk to me. It was such an amazing honor to get this interview. So, Ron, thank you so much. And, guys, hey, be sure you hit that subscribe button, click the notification bell. Keep looking back for more great content to come out here on Everything 101. I'll see you soon.